Black, remember that, just in case we ever face to face and make contact. The title held by me, MIB, is what you think you saw, you did not see. So don't be what the stands now for the right. Put the black gray bands on, walk in shadow, move in silence, guard against extraterrestrial violence. We ain't on no government list, we straight, don't exist, no names and no future plans. Saw some strange watch your back, but you never quite know where the MIBs is at. Knock on the horizon, bright light, inside tight, camera zooming in your pens and tune. But then like boom, black suits fill the room up. Quick, quick, let's talk with the witnesses. Hypnotizer, normalizer, living the dreams, turn the fantasies. Ain't no MIBs, can I believe what we say, that's the way we kick it. Yeah, I mean, a super noisy cricket getting wicked on you. We're your first, last, and only line of defense against the worst of the universe. So don't fear us, cheer us. If you ever get near us, don't jeer us. Fearless, and my feet's freezing up off the flag. Yes, it's four men in black. Let me see you just bounce with me, just bounce with me, just bounce with me. Come on, let me see you just slide with me, just slide with me, just slide with me. Come on, let me see you take a walk with me, just walk with me, take a walk with me. Come on, baby, network. Now freeze. I don't want to lose you now.
All right. Good evening, everyone. Good evening. Good evening. Come on in. Come on in. That's how we do. You know how I do. I'm the queen of radio. By the way, the music that is played on this program, I have no copyrights or profit intentions. So it's all on YouTube. You can follow that on YouTube to find these great videos. It kind of messed up at the beginning. When I tried to play the Men in Black, but you know the story, you know the deal. Okay, you know how we start off. We start off with the Lord's Prayer, and then I give the prayer for the nation, and then we get into the groove of why we all are here. If I can get everyone to bow their heads as we get ready to begin our session with giving honor and glory to God. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Now, for the prayer for the nation. Father God, we come to you in these times of trouble within this year of 2020. We have been at a great burden and high level of stress. You said that if we call upon your name in our sickness and our health and in distress, that you would provide us with the necessary tools to defend ourselves as well as to defeat our enemies. Lord, today we must hold you at your word for our own safety. We must hold you at your word for our own healing. We must hold you at your word for being the coat of armor, which is also sealed in your blood. Also, Father God, as well, we must not forget that you have taught us all that you are the beginning, the middle, and the end. We have all been taught to be fearless in the face of our enemies. We have all been taught to rebuke the devil 7 times in completion, for us to be free from his spell and his fake powers and fake authority. In these times of trouble, Satan has came. Yes, Lord, he has came and he has smiled in our face and spoke nothing about massive lies to destroy your people. These men who have created this sickness by a serum called the COVID-19. These men who have created this serum has been killing and not healing. These men has also tried to create the microchip so they could depopulate the world in which you have created. These people became rich by using the power of their money to destroy this earth. It is time for a change by the hands of all people. Father God, at no time have you appointed these men to be your partner on any of your earth creation. It is believed that you are the only God that has created the heavens and the earth, and we, the people in the earth, shall inherit all that is in it, in this earth. And for the next last week that's coming up, we will continue the people to rebuke Satan and his army by doing the following. Number one, for these men who have created this COVID-19, we rebuke you in the name of Jesus. For the men who have demanded that we wear masks to suffocate ourselves from breathing, we rebuke you in the name of Jesus. For the men or women who have created these false courtrooms and making false judgment on people with their continuous lies and false verdicts, we rebuke you in the name of Jesus. For the media who has been withholding the truth and spreading their selective lies and not giving us the truth that we are so in desire to know and need about, we rebuke you in the name of Jesus. For all the people who have been protesting and rioting for their own selfish and wicked reasons, we rebuke you in the name of Jesus. For all these people who have been made themselves financially rich by creating a microchip to gain control over this land and its people, we rebuke you in the name of Jesus. For all the groups who carry poor government, KKK, and officers who have been killing people, we must finally rebuke you in the name of Jesus. No more will we, the people, allow you to come, steal, and destroy the land that God has set for us to be a part of and to enjoy. We will now pray to God to return each one of you to the fiery pits of hell for once you came. And we seal this prayer in the name of Jesus. Ladies and gentlemen, I have been reciting this prayer for all seven messages that I have been recording. And I suggest that everyone out there that is listening to this video to do the same. As we continue to practice and praying and rebuking the devil in the name of Jesus, that is the only way that the devil is going to flee. Now, after these seven video lessons are completed, I do plan on going back to my writing and my music. And for all the ones who have been asking about my band, again, the band will be back in effect for 2021. And you need to stay tuned to the channel, as well as the details as they become available. Now, for this video disclaimer, all of the contents will be expressed come from my own personal research and personal experiences. No third party has been involved. And also the contents of this program may sometimes be graphic, so please be aware and be advised. These videos are unfiltered and sometimes can be uncensored. So again, everyone is to be advised. Also, for the songs that I started this lesson plan up, I have no copyrights or profit intentions. I have no ownerships to any part of the music that has been played by The Emotions or Will Smith. So just to let you know, we have to say that at the beginning of all video recordings. Also, to reach out to me, I want you to get your paper and pen and write this down. I want you to go to atorclass101@gmail.com. That's class101@gmail.com. For all comments, questions, concern, or to receive your free ebook, which is valued at $25, to have a copy of the new list of laws that you want to have changed for your community, or if you want to join the free wholesale club by my sponsor. This wholesale club is only by personal invites. It's not advertised to the general public. So in order to get that code, ladies and gentlemen, you got to contact me and I will send you that free code so you can get yourself logged in and logged on. Again, that is atorclass101@gmail.com. Now, taken from the past lessons that I promised, after I had been listening to All the Crap by Ice Cube, I had made a promise to the ones who has been following me that I will be doing the Black American Plan. Matter of fact, I'm halfway done with it. I'm almost done with it. So anyone that is interested in seeing a well-presented presentation on behalf of Black people, you can also email me at atorclass101@gmail.com. Also, let's see. My plan, also, I want everybody to know that part of that plan is going to be talking about white government as well as what they are supposed to be doing for us. And I'm going to be filing those pages in the Supreme Court. So I'm not gonna pass go. I'm gonna give a copy to Ice Cube so he'll know how to present on behalf of Black people. And anybody else that is interested, you're more than welcome to get a copy. Black people, we need to stop complaining and get down to business. Like I said many times before, the power is in the pen before any time we can start seeing some action to be taking place. For all donations, please send a digital invoice to touchofreality2@gmail.com. Again, that's touchofreality2@gmail.com. And the theme for tonight, or for today, well, I guess today would be tonight, depending on where you're joining in at. Tonight's theme is when is it time? When we're when did I? I'm tongue twisted. I don't know what it is. I think I had too much pineapple juice earlier. But anyway, when are we remembering the good times as well as how to be self-employed? Normally at this time, I would be speaking on who has been in the news, but and doing my commentary. But today, I really don't want to be bothered with talking about what's going on in the news because we're getting very close to this election. So I want to get down to our weekly lesson, if I may. Folks, you probably noticed that this is a presentation that is pre-recorded. I'm pre-recording this because, like I said again, we're only 1 week away from the election and we don't know what's going to go down a week from now. So I want to get this in, get it on. And I know that there will be a lot of dumbass people out there casting their vote for one of these moron candidates instead of holding on to the vote, like I had been saying that we as a nation need to do in order for us to get some real results. But you know, people are hard-headed. You know, people are gonna do what they wanna do. So, oh well, it is what it is. Which is the reason why I will be filing. And I say again, I'm going to be filing a lot of document and a lot of pages to the Supreme Court on behalf of my Black people. And after I file this, I'm going to do a promotion. I will need about 1 million signatures to keep, and this is to keep the laws to be valid, or, I mean, we can also get these people out of office and have them stay out of office. But again, I've said this time and time and time again, it's going to take the power of the pen and not just my signature, but we're going to need everybody's signature. So I'm telling you, this is a fight where you don't want to invite a chihuahua to a pit bull fight. And I've already gotten to the point of being, I'm just fed up. I'm tired of talking. I'm tired of, you know, trying to be nice about this whole thing. I'm fed up with this whole stuff that's going on. Look, the way I feel about this whole mess, I'm getting ready to throw a monkey wrench in their whole program. So don't blink because you might miss something. I keep telling you, I am the queen on this chessboard. And all these warriors and knights will be soon to be protecting me. So I need everybody to pay close attention to my next move because I'm, like I said again, I'm not playing. We, the masses of the people, do not understand all how laws are created. But to share with you, laws are created by us. I don't know how many times I'm going to have to say this, but I'm going to keep saying it until somebody reaches say, oh yeah, I got it now. She's saying that it's us, not them. Okay? They are people working for us, not the way around. If this, ladies and gentlemen, I want y'all to think about this. If this was a job, we, the people, are the employer. And they are the employee. And I don't know why people walk around as if they are so scared and, oh God, I don't know what I'm gonna do. And government is doing this and government is doing that. Well, you know what? We have the power to make them stop. If we have to treat them like children, okay, let's give them a timeout. You know, it's their job that they have been hired to do. And that is for us. What I can't understand is what is everybody so afraid of? This is what I can't understand. What is it that everybody is afraid of? You see, if anybody is very, now see, I don't pretend, I've said this before. I don't know everything about the Bible. I don't know everything about the history of the Bible, but I do know some passages. I know that God has created Satan. And then for Satan to be removed, we got to cast him back to the fiery pits of hell from whence he once came. You don't get ice water in hell, folks. You got to say this in your daily prayers, and hopefully you can say it 7 times. So keep praying that we're going to get all of these devils that is posing themselves as white government. We're gonna get these bastards out of here. Because I'm telling you, and I'm gonna tell you another thing. I haven't said anything, but there is more to this thing that meets the eye. And I'm not going to devour, I'm not going to talk about it on my program, not just yet, because what I'm doing, folks, sometimes you don't let your right hand know what your left hand is doing. So I'm putting some stuff together that's just going to, everybody going to be like, what? Everybody going to go, it's going to be like, what did she just say? Uh-huh. It's one of those moments. So this is the reason why I say you got to stay focused. If you stay with me, you're going to understand it as I unfold all of these pieces together. Now, tonight, we are on lesson 6, guys. And lesson 7, I'm going to do live this Thursday because next week will be the election week, and we don't know what the heck's going to go down. We don't know where everybody's mindset is going to be. So I'm trying to get all of this stuff out to you before anything takes place. We don't know what's going on. I'm just going to keep it in God's hand that everybody will stay blessed and stay safe. But I don't know. You just never know. So I'm doing a little bit of early stuff for everybody's benefit. Okay. Now, as I was saying, getting back on the forefront here, lesson 6. The reason why, if you guys go back to some of my other lesson plans, I said how important it is to start teaching kids on how to earn a living and how to learn how to work. I'm telling you, it makes a major, major, major difference. You see, if these parents do not start teaching these kids now, these kids are going to grow up thinking that they don't have to earn it because you're always giving it to them. And we need to set an example. Not only does it give a positive example, but it gives each one of these kids great self-esteem as they come into adulthood. You know what I'm saying? And I'm gonna talk about myself a little bit this evening. Usually I don't like to talk about myself, but I'm gonna talk about myself a little bit tonight. And before I forget, the song Men in Black, I wanna send this shout out. I tried to play the song, but kind of skipped around. I don't know with the speaker or the sound, so I apologize for that. I don't do any editing with these tapes. I want you to get it in the raw. You're gonna get the good, the bad, the ugly, the in between. It already takes me 6 hours to put together a format for as to what I need to say. So I don't want to spend another 6 hours revamping this information. But anyway, I played the Men in Black, which is from the great talented music rap artist, producer, actor, Mr. Will Smith. I call him Big Sexy because I used to love to watch him from Fresh Prince. But anyway, that song is a tribute and dedication to all races of militia groups. I found out that there are more than just the not fucking around coalition. There are more groups that are forming themselves against government and their men and women. I mean, these men and women are bold. I mean, I don't know what to say for them. I mean, they are so bold enough to carry a weapon and they're willing to fight for the race of their people. The only reason why the Black militia groups are talking more is because Black people who have suffered longest and they have suffered the hardest. So I don't care whether you are standing up for Mexicans, whites, or whatever. I'm finding out that these militia groups are not forming to go against Black people, but they're forming because they have a problem with government. So that was a real shock to me because I figured, well, you know, Black people have been the target for all these different hate groups. And I'm like, but now, I mean, after talking to some of these people, they're saying that, no, we have a problem with the way government is being run. So government has a real serious problem on their hands right now when you got a nation of people that's getting ready to go against you. and all the monkey mess that they have been provide the lies. I mean, the lies has been coming back and forth. I mean, throwing a rock and hiding their hand. I mean, people are, I mean, folks, look, I'm just only one person. People are standing up saying, look, we're fed up with this crap. It's time for, and now that they see these black militia groups standing up for black people, now you got all these other nationalities saying, hey, but wait a minute, if the black people can do it, then let me do it. You know, different strokes for different folks. That's all I'm saying. So I'm just going to say, I played the Men in Black song in dedication to all the groups who are bold enough to carry a, you know, to carry a weapon and to stand up and stand for their people, their race. I commend you. I don't care what race you are. I know that, you know, the black militia is doing it for us, but now I'm starting to see other groups doing it for their race. So I commend you. I don't have any problem one way or the other, because at the end of the day, I'm going to still put it all in God's hand and let God work his miracle as to what he needs to be done for his earth. So anyway, getting back on our lesson plan for this evening, we're going to first start off and kick it off by pointing out on how to be self-employed. I can't stress this enough when I talk about getting our children. The children need to be the starting point of teaching them how to be self-employed. I'm going to go back, and I got to say this, and like I said, I'm going to talk about myself this evening. When I was a child, I learned the game of how to hustle and flow. I'm trying to tell you, I'm going back to old school, y'all. In the third grade, I learned how to sell Nihilators. There was this little candy, you know, these little square candies. I don't know. You got to be old school in order to know where I'm coming from with this. there was this little candy called Nihilators. And let me tell you, hon, my parents sent me to a Catholic school. And every Friday, I would have my socks filled with these Nihilators. You know, kids. I mean, I was giving school kids were getting candy credits. And I can remember my ride or die chick at the time. Her name was Lynette Flowers. Lynette took the odd number classrooms, and I took the, you know, I took the even number classrooms, because we wanted to make sure that everybody got their candy on Friday. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you got to be hustling, flowing. Every Monday, you know, because my father would bring in truckloads of candy on Friday night, you know, because Friday was payday. So I would get my school bag and my socks, you know, color-coded socks. They knew what time. And we just, I'm telling you, memories as a kid doing the hustle of being a candy girl. I was a candy girl. I can't say candy boy. But anyway, like I said, Lynette had the odd number classrooms, and I had the even numbers, you know. And I can tell you, them darn Boston baked beans, them jawbreakers, and them lemonheads, I mean, that was a special request. You couldn't just play, because them things was hard as heck trying to stuff that stuff down your socks. And we ain't even talking about those chocolate whoppers. And you know what? Chocolate whoppers, I really didn't like those. Them things was kind of nasty. I don't know. I mean, everybody have their own taste when it comes to candy. But that was one. Them chocolate whoppers was kind of goofy. Because if you smash it in your sock and you got this brown gook coming all down your leg and stuff, that looked like some unfresh boo-boo. You know, that then people be like, oh, she used the bathroom on herself. So, you know, we got to the point where we stopped putting the whoppers in our sock. So we had to put that in our Barbie lunchbox. Yeah, we had Barbie and, you know, the big head Barbies. That see, you got to be old. You old school players know what I'm talking about. You know, and see, back in the day, if you had your own little hustle, boy, we never ran out of money. I'm telling you, every single weekend, we were at the movie theater watching the latest Bruce Lee movies or Godzilla movie. I don't know about you, but I love me some Godzilla. Boy, Godzilla is the shit. You know, Godzilla was the boy, man. Godzilla, I mean, I'm talking about the old Godzilla. I ain't really caring about that new digital Godzilla. See, that new digital Godzilla don't have no personality. You know, that old Godzilla be wipe his nose and say, yeah, come on, bro. Come on, bro. I'm finna, man, and set your ass on fire. He go, I mean, man, you talking about having some fun and seeing that up on that big screen. Man, we had enough. After we sold candy, I'm telling you, after we sold candy, we treated everybody, all our friends who didn't have no money to go to the movies, we were depending on how much, you know, how much candy we sold that week, and depending on how much candy we had in our stocks, we would treat everybody to either a movie or, get this. This just came to my memory. We would, if we didn't go to the movies, we did the crazy leg at the skating rink parties. And in Chicago, it was called the Screaming Wheels out there in Markham, Illinois. And the Loop skating rink in Chi-Town. You know what I'm talking about. We had that, everybody remember that song, Roll, Bounce, Skate, Rock. Man, I'm telling you, that song was the shit. We can remember Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five was singing The Message, Don't Push Me to the Edge. You know what I'm talking about. See, that's old school. That's old school. And what about that? What about the King of Rap, Mr. Curtis Blow? Boy, that boy can sing with that Christmas song and These Are the Breaks, man. You couldn't tell us nothing. You could not tell us nothing. That, I mean, whoo. Boy, that brings back some memories. That gets me excited. I'm that gives me a happy, that puts me in a happy spirit, in a happy mood, just to think about all of the old songs and remembering all them old school rappers. And just, you know, school was fun. You know, school was the best. And oh, and another reason, another great memory I want to share with you. And I put some of these memories in my book. Another fine memory that I had was my girls. Man, my first memory of singing in the schoolyard. Wait a minute. It was me, Kim, Sherry, and Dotanya. Yes. See, I was the logical one. You know, I'm telling you, I had to make sense out of everything. Kim was the one, the boys all would look at Kim because of her big boobs. I mean, Kim, for Kim to be in grammar school, that girl had a big chest on her. Wasn't too bright. Wasn't, you know, she was missing some marbles upstairs, but she was a cutie. I mean, you know, she had the big, you know, the protruding of the breast. And, you know, God, Pat, when they were passing out breast parts and body parts, she got in the line twice. I kid you not. Sherry, oh man, Sherry was the most popular girl in school. Everybody just loved her because she just had that hair that just blew in the wind, like, oh, you know, like, I'm, you know, whatever. But that was my girl. Those girls were my road dogs. I kid you not. And then there was Dotanya. Oh man. Folks, let me tell you something. You did not want to run up on Dotanya. Dotanya was the bodyguard, but that big bitch could sing. I'm just saying. If you put memory for Dotanya, if you guys could ever remember the movie of what's that Eddie Murphy movie, Norbit, with Rakisha, whatever that was Dotanya. Completely all the way. I mean, she would pick you up and slam your ass across the room. So nobody really messed with Dotanya. I mean, you know, that's like a Great Dane being in a room, you know, with chihuahuas or something. But she was protective. I will admit, Dotanya was very protective of us. So I can remember we were doo-wopping. We were the first female doo-wopping group. And we were back in the schoolyard singing Don't Ask My Neighbor. Y'all don't know nothing about that. See, I'm telling my age up in here. But we would be in the schoolyard practicing that Don't Ask My Neighbor. We looked up to the emotions. Honey, let me tell you something. I went to school with some real fine bitches. I ain't talking about bitch. I'm talking about bitches, you know, with the oomph that put your foot in your ass type bitches. I mean, you couldn't tell us nothing. And these bitches were so cute, they made my ass look ugly, you know. And I'm gonna tell you something. And because I had a complex coming up. I ain't gonna even lie to you. This is okay. Can we talk? I had a complex coming up. I really, really don't like taking pictures. I really don't. I don't like being in front of a camera. And anybody that knows me on a personal level, my friends, my family, they have to practically trick me into taking pictures. I'm really not, you have to catch me in the mood. And if it wasn't for the fact that this is the sign of the time and everybody's on YouTube and I want a million people to follow me and, you know, but if it wasn't for the sign of the time, I would be hiding behind a sheet or something because I'm really not into the camera thing. If I could avoid it, I'll try to avoid it at all costs. And not only that, you know, as you being a child trying to be raised up and being around all these other different school kids, I could remember. Oh, I gotta tell you this. I can remember two schoolboys betting a dime, ladies and gentlemen. They betted a dime not to kiss me. Mm-hmm. I'll never forget it. Mm-hmm. It was Keith Austin and Casey Graham. Mm-hmm. And to tell you how karma works, this is kind of funny. I saw Keith Austin 3 years ago. And boy, baby, bye. That dude is so ugly that death is on a fresh new repass. I kid you not. That dude is so ugly. He is not caste friendly. I mean, his mama should have told him that, son, you're not going to grow up and you're not going to be pretty. You're not all that, you know, that's not working for you at all. So, man, I mean, I looked at that and I got sick to my stomach. I mean, that dude is so ugly. But anyway. Anyway, getting back to being self-employed, Papa E. See, everybody called my father Papa E, which was, you know, for the people and friends that knew him. His name was Mr. Willie Evans. Papa E, you know, he was the foreman. My dad was the foreman of community stores, Ventures. If you ever shopped at a Venture store or a Zare store, my father would be selling cases of candy right outside the garage. And on Halloween, boy, you couldn't tell us nothing. Halloween, we had candy wrapped around all the way around 112th Street, going all the way far down as what? Had to have been about four blocks to Michigan. And I'm telling you folks, if candy was crack cocaine, we'd have been rich out of Roseland. Cause I mean, he was the candy man. And He taught me, I got to take my hat off to Papa E, because he taught me how to make it work. And that's exactly what I did. I made it work. I kept some money in my pocket. I ain't got time to play with you, because I don't want nobody come telling me, oh, well, you know, you got to wait till my next paycheck. No, this is what people take advantage of. They think because you're an only child, oh, well, your parents spoiled you. No, they didn't. My father, my first job, folks, was washing ashtrays. Yes. We had heavy smokers because we had families that would come over every weekend to party hardy and do the Soul Train dance and play the guitars and the instruments. And we would eat and they would drink and, you know, playing their blues and all kinds of stuff. Have them house party with the blue strobe lights. Y'all don't know nothing about that. See, that's when fun, and that's when family used to have fun. See, I didn't have time to be waiting on a paycheck. My father would say, look, here's your money. This is your allowance. If you want to do some extra work, we can find a job for you to do, because I'm not going to sit up here. You need to learn how to go out there and fence for yourself, because your parents is not going to always be there for you. And true enough, he meant what he said. He said, look, I'm going to teach you how to do this hustle and flow. That way you ain't never got to worry on nobody. And I do mean nobody to take care of you. So, you know, it is what it is. All right. Now we're going to move on. We're going to move on to the next segment. Tonight, as I said, I'm going to teach you guys how to how to stop living from paycheck to paycheck. So if you are sitting in your living room or whatever, this is the time that you can go put this tape on pause. Go pause, get your paper and pen, get your notebook. I tell you, you always got to have pen and paper around me, because I'm going to always give you something that you can learn from and you can take some notes from. And I want you to go ahead and share this. Share everything that you possibly can with these lessons, because, you know, when you become a blessing for somebody else, God makes it possible for you to get double blessings. So I want everybody to, you know, to be a blessing to someone else, like I'm trying to be a blessing for you. Now, as I was saying, here's a brief story. All my life, I want everybody to know, all my life, I have helped people to become rich. And what really behooved me is that when I needed a dollar, couldn't find nobody. Nobody could help. Nobody could say, well, no, I can't do nothing for you. You're going to have to catch me on payday. And that payday never came. So I said, okay, I got to go back to the way I was raised. Because if I had to depend on people out there, people will disappear. Go and ask somebody for some money and see how fast they disappear on you. You want a clear room, especially with Black people. If you want a clear room with Black people, ask them for a dollar and see how fast they run, faster than the road runner on crack. Now, anyway, I can remember, you know, I've always been an excellent salesperson. You know, I can remember when I helped Bank of America reach their first $1 billion mark. And that happened in the summer of 2007. Yeah. It was the summer of 2007. And do you know they were so cheap? They didn't even give me a cash bonus for helping them to reach their mark. Instead, they give me some little funky sterling cup with a chocolate bar on the end. I'm like, now, out of all the work, it took me exactly 10 months to help them to get that amount of money. And all they could think of is just to give me a damn cup with some damn chocolate. I could have bought my own damn cup and put my own damn chocolate in it. And at least they could have been a Hershey chocolate instead of, I think it was a Dove. I think it was a Dove chocolate bar that they put in the cup. They could have kept that crap. You know, but see, the thing is, folks, all of my life, I've been taking care of other people. And now I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I'm just going to get ready to, and start doing me. I don't have any plans on being rich. And I'm going to tell you the reason why. When the more money you have, the more problems you have. And I can remember going back to my favorite Notorious Big song when he says, more money, more problems. You ain't never lied on that. So my life, it has taught me to, my true riches is coming from me being and staying free and being in my own peace of mind. You know what I'm saying? Because I'm going to tell you something, whether you know it or not, being at peace and being free are two things that money cannot buy at no amount and no cost. Money cannot buy you a place. Another thing, this is another thing I thought of. You know, all these rich people got this money and they're holding on tighter than a frog with a pin stuck up behind or something. They're holding on to this money. But guess what, folks? When you leave this world, you can't take that money with you. So why are you holding on to it? Why are they holding on to it? You can't take it. So, and it's sure in the hell not going to get you a place in heaven with it. So, let me tell you something, as long as I got all of my day-to-day needs and I fall in, maybe one day I'll fall in love with someone and me and him can sit on the back porch and enjoy the sunset. The sunrise, because my back, I get the sunrise, I don't get the sunset. But we can enjoy the sunrise on my back porch. And see, I just want simple things. And I figure if you got simple things in life, you already rich. You know, you're already rich. And I say again, I wish I could find a million people who carried the same belief. You know what I'm saying? I'm looking for a million people who wants to know about the truth and not all of this, all of these fairy tale and how to get there and what it takes to make it, you know, make things work. So, you know, that's just my dream. You know, I don't ask for much. I really don't. Now, here are some things on teaching you how to budget. And this is from my own personal experiences. I didn't read this out of a book. This is what I've learned personally, which is probably the reason why today I have two houses. I have two homes. I have two homes, two cars, two cats. I'm good. I'm very much into antique cars. I love antique cars. I think my favorite car is a Rolls Royce. But if I had to think about it, I like other cars, like cars that got a little bit of speed into it, something like that. But anyway, I love antique cars. I love going to antique shows, and I was a Tom girl or Tomboy. I don't know which one they called it. I used to beat the crap out of the boys in my area, in my neighborhood. You know, they know me. That just ain't gonna work. I whooped their tails and I whooped it good. So anyway, but getting back to this, budgeting, the way I have budget, and it has worked very successfully for me. So I'm hoping that I can share it with someone and maybe, you know, you can start budgeting for yourself. There are a couple of steps and I will try to go slow on telling you what the steps are. Number one, the very first thing about budgeting is to pay yourself. You got to pay yourself. You got to set your own percentage of what you are comfortable with. Most of the time, people live from paycheck to paycheck. So you know how much you're getting paid per week. So you have to set the amount as to how much you're going to pay yourself. Okay. Personally, and here comes step number two. As I'm paying myself, I break it up into seven parts. Okay. If I make $300, I'm just using this as an example. If I make $300, I'm going to divide that $300 into seven parts. Okay. And that will tell me how much I should be paying myself. Now, to break it up into seven parts, the first part is for you to pay yourself. Pay yourself or your family, whichever one you think is the most important at that time. Number two, part of that part is to pay for your housing or making sure that you have a roof over your head. Yes, keeping a roof over the head is very, 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 very important. Number three, make sure you're paying for your transportation. I don't know about you, but I take the bus only when I feel like being around other people. I have two great running cars, antique cars that I drive. As long as my stuff is paid for, I don't really care. But transportation is a must, especially if you live in like a little small town like I do. Number four, make sure you got food. Yes, that's another essential. That's very important. You can't imagine how important having food is. You gotta eat, folks. So number four is food. Number five is any type of household items or miscellaneous things. Household items meaning that you gotta go shopping for your toiletries, your shampoos, your soap. You gotta put your car insurance, home insurance, life insurance. All of these are what I call miscellaneous. You really need to, you know, this is something that you really should not be paying for every month if you stock up like me, because I'll go and buy like 50 rolls of bathroom tissue to last me for however long before I have to go shopping for that again. So these are your miscellaneous. Also, your credit card payments and stuff that it's important, but it's not majorly important. You know, you got to get around to you know, you got to pay your utilities. Oh, see, all of that to me is miscellaneous. Number six, you got to have some funds for emergency. I don't care, guys, every female that is in existence have a emergency stash. Every female has an emergency stash because you don't never know where you're going to run into a problem. You just don't never know. So it's always good to have that. And number seven, everybody should have enough money for either entertainment, where you're going out or treating yourself to dinner, or vacations. I've gotten to the point, I would like to think that I would like to be able to see every tropical island, because I can't stand cold weather. I hate cold weather with a passion. But I am so interested in and seeing all the possible islands that I can possibly see. Now, one island that I'm just not gonna go to, and I don't care. I've heard about these places that got these nude beaches. I'm not showing my glory to nobody. I already have a problem with trying to be on camera and taking pictures, and now you want me to be naked? You that real naked? Oh no, I can't do that. No. I'm still trying to figure out how we can, take showers in our clothes. You know, because I'm just not there yet with taking off clothes. I just can't be doing all of that. So anyway, once you get into a good at budgeting, you will find yourself having more money in your pocket at the end of the month. And when you pay off one thing, you got to go back and start paying off everything else. That way, if you should ever fall short on any time frame, then it'll already be covered. So if you're anything like me, I'm going to tell you something. I can't stand bills. I can't do that monthly stuff. See, I like to get it out and get it over with. You know, that's what I'm about. I can't be doing that monthly stuff. That monthly stuff will drive you absolutely crazy. You know, I can live with it. I can live with it if I'm paying it like every 2 months or 3 months or maybe twice a year or maybe once a year. I don't really care. But that monthly thing, I can't. No. Because see, I may get in the mood to do something else with my money, and you know, it just can't work out that way. Now, also moving on. I want to keep it moving because time is of essence, and I know everybody else got other things that they could be doing. Get the money that is owed to you. And I want you guys to start paying attention to your receipts when you buy something. Stop spending your money on stuff that you really don't need to have. And another thing, stop going to the grocery store hungry. You are never supposed to go to a grocery store being hungry. If you gotta eat, put something on your stomach to satisfy that crave. And then get yourself in that store, because I'm going to tell you something. There is a store in my town that has nothing but fresh vegetables and fresh exotic fruits from all across the world. And I'll go in that store and I will lose my mind in the fruit section, because I love pomegranates. I absolutely love pomegranates. And I like to get those things on sale if I can. If it's in season. But this store is so good about stocking up on exotic fruits. And I really love to keep myself healthy with those things. So I try not to go in there and lose my mind. I really do. And then I'm off to my other stores like Walmart. I go to different stores for different things, depending on what it is I need for the household. And if you're anything like me, grocery stores are the best place to overspend. Reason why I say that, because my weakness, and see, you got to know your weakness when you go in these places. My weakness is the bakery. Oh my goodness. I am going over to that bakery and looking at those apple fritters and that cheesecake and those apple pie slices. Oh my goodness. You know, the devil is a lie. The devil is a complete lie. So I have to make sure that I don't go in and I crave sweets like like it's in, like I could do it in a needle or something. And another thing, another trick, when you go out to a restaurant, make sure you order water. Don't get caught up in drinking alcohol or sodas or whatever. Don't do that, because this is what I found out, folks. They have a drinking tax. Uh-huh. See, I looked at this. I went out to someplace, and I'm not really a, if I'm going to drink like Hennessy or something, grown folks alcohol, I'm going to do that in the privacy of my own home. But I looked at the menu, and I said, well, ma'am, you charged me for the drink, but what is this additional $3 for? Well, we have what we call an alcohol drink tax to make sure that you're over the age that you're capable of drinking. Said, what? Wait a minute. You mean to tell me you're going to charge me an additional $3 per glass? This is per glass, folks. So this is the reason why I say, if you're going to drink water when you go out. I'm telling you, you could have bought a whole case of Pepsi for the charge that these guys are charging you in these restaurants. And another thing that you don't want to get charged for is your condiments. I had a restaurant. I kid you not. They tried to charge me an extra $2 for ranch dressing. Ranch dressing or honey mustard when you order those buffalo wings. Man, I was like, by the time you get through paying for the mysterious drink charge and this charge and the condiment charge, that's a whole meal that you just got out of. So start paying attention to all of your expenses. And here's another thing that behooved me about bill paying. I have a Firestone credit card, auto credit card that comes from a third party company. And so I had to take my car in to get some tires. It was more than tires. I had to do some tires for my second car. And then I had to have them put a new battery because the battery is getting old. So by the amount of work that I had done, the bill came to about, I don't know, maybe $500 and some. I had about $500 some worth of work done for my first car. When I got the bill, the woman gonna say, well, we got to charge you an additional $35. And I said, well, wait a minute, ma'am. You're charging, now I didn't already pay the bill. And you know, when you got a credit card, they give you the option to pay the thing off or pay an additional fee. So I said, well, wait a minute. My due date is not until the 18th of the month. So how are you charging me on the 6th? And then she said, well, it's a $35 charge just in case you don't see your bill. Wait a minute, hold the hell on. You're going to charge me an extra $35 in case I miss the bill. And then you're going to turn around and charge me an interest on the bill for a bill that's already paid. She said, yes, that's how that works. Boy, Jesus better get behind me, because I was like, oh, okay. Before I go off on you, now I've already paid $500 and some for the repair of my car. The first car. Now you're going to come tell me that I got to pay you an additional. Wait a minute. It just didn't come for the $35. It was $35 first. And then it was a $17 car charge for going through another third party. So by the time I looked at the bill, it was up to about $78 and the bill was already paid. So when I called them, I said, well, I didn't use your service. So why would you charge me $78 for a bill that was already paid? So she was like, well, you knew that. And then she had, and this is what behooves me, she had the audacity to get smart. Oh, hell no, bitch. I know damn well you didn't just get smart with me about money that I'm spending. Oh, jump back. Look out now. You talking to an old school player here. So I had to find Jesus for a moment. I had to pray real solid, like, Jesus, take the wheel, because if this woman was in front of me, I'd be choking the shit out of her. That's just how I felt. So at the end of the day, I said, you know what? She says, well, I don't have no authority. I don't have no authority to take these charges off. I said, well, I'll tell you what, I'm through talking to you. I said, if you don't have no authority to take these charges off my bill, then I suggest you get somebody on this phone to handle this. Well, she said, well, you're calling me out of Kansas City and you need to call somebody out of Texas in order for this to be resolved. I said, lady, I don't give a damn if we got to go to Zimbabwe. You better take these. We better find a way to get this off of my bill because I already paid Firestone. Firestone was already paid the $500 for the work that they did on my car. So I'm not going to sit up here and allow you to continue to bill me for a service that I never used. So that was like, I'm telling you, folks, you got to pay attention because you may be paying for somebody else's bill. I'm just keeping it real. So another story, ripoff. I took my second car. Okay. My second car needed to have all four brand new tires on my Chevy Impala. I call that boss hog. That's, you know, mama's car. My mother left that car to me when she passed away in 2013. So her car is called boss hog. And so boss hog, I saw a sale on the tires. I don't know if anybody knows anything about tires, but this was for a Chevy Impala. I think it was the size 16 tires, 16 or 18. I don't know what it was. But anyway, the sale price was $67, okay, per tire. And so the man said, well, it's going to cost about, you know, and I calculated it. And I this was a great sale, so I wanted to take advantage of the sale. The whole four tires were supposed to come to $268. Now, I know how to add, I know how to multiply, and I know how to subtract. So $67 times four is $268. And I said, okay, well, I'll just go in my pocket and give them cash and let them be done with it. Now, I left my car there, mind you, okay? I left my car there because, and that's not like me to leave my car nowhere, not for a long period of time, but I had other things I needed to catch up on, and you know how you get caught up on something, then you got to come back, and then you got to do this and this, that, this, whatever. Okay, now I caught. I come back, and the man gave me the bill, and I said, "Wait a minute!" I looked at the bill, and you know how you do a double take. You like, what the hell? You know, you looked at the bill, and the bill. I'm thinking that it said $250. That's what I thought. That's what my brain was programming for me to think. I thought it was saying $250. The man said it was $2,500. I said, jump back, sister girl, jump back. Hold him up, wait a minute. So I walked outside. I walked outside. I said, let me clear my throat. And because maybe he didn't mean to put an extra zero on this bill. You know, so I said, sir, can you explain to me what exactly you had on this bill to make? I said, did you do something else to my car other than put four tires on the car? Is what I'm asking. And so he says, no, ma'am, I did not. And so I said, well, do you see what I see on this bill? He says, yes, I see what the bill says. I said, well, can you read that bill off to me? Because, maybe I need another pair of glasses. He said the bill is $2,500. I said, okay. $2,500 for four tires that was supposed to have been on sale. Right? He said, yes. So I said, well, can you show me can you give me a copy? He said, oh, I don't have that right now. I said, oh hell yeah, you better have it. I said, you need to give me a breakdown of what you're charging me. I need to see this visually with my glasses, and I'm gonna borrow somebody else's glasses to look at this. So he goes and I look at the bill. The bill says that the man charged me for the use of his tools to take the tires off of my car. Hold them up now. I'm going to break it down for you. because I know y'all are just as behooved as I am. He charged me for the usage of his tools. That was number one. He charged me an auto membership to a club I knew nothing about. He charged me to pay for the insurance on his business, his shop business. That was listed on there, which I was supposed to pay for. I guess that was for the rest of the world to pay. And then he said that because of the pandemic and the lockdown, mind you, I had to pay the tire labor cost of $200. It cost him, he tried to charge me $200 per tire for labor. I said, okay, all right. Okay, player. All right. I said, I tell you what you do. And I'm trying to, you know, I'm being the calm, cool, collected person that I am. I said, son, I think you're going to need to call for backup. He says, why, ma'am? You're not in any great danger. I said, no, son, but you are, because I'm going to knock the fuck out of you. Yes, if you don't get up off your lily white ass and take this bullshit off my goddamn bill, it's going to be all hell broke loose up in here. I must have stupid written all over my forehead or something. And then so he was like, oh, but, and then customers started to come in, and you really don't want to see a black woman act the fool about when you getting ready to be charged $2,500 for four tires that needed to be put on a Chevy Impala. So he was like, and then after he said, well, okay, we can make a deal. I said, oh, no, son. No. We're not making no deals. Because he was getting ready to call himself trying to hold my car hostage. You know, he's like, well, ma'am, you got to understand we're going through a pandemic. I said, it's going to be a pandemic on your ass if you don't get this $2,500 off this bill. So after he took all of these mysterious charges, I paid him $400 and $402.80 for the cost of the labor or whatever, putting four brand new tires on my car. So I guess, you know, women can be a victim to stuff like this, especially when you go in and try to get your car repaired for things. So you got to be mindful. You just got to be mindful. Anyway, another way to get the money that you are owed. And this is for anybody who has ever been stopped by the police. You know, I'm just going to be real with you. You need to go back to lesson three. And I think I missed a point. I think I missed a point in lesson three that I need to share with you guys. I don't think I told you how you could get paid when you are assaulted by a police officer and he gets belligerent. What everybody needs to know is that police has what they call an insurance bond. The insurance bond is up to $2 million per officer. In the event that you are arrested and assaulted and harassed without reasonable cause. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, that is a correct statement. You get up to $2 million on each police officer that approaches you on some foolishness. And if you ever catch a crooked judge, I don't care what level they're on, a crooked judge, a crooked sheriff, or a crooked court bail's bondman, government keeps a $5 million bond on them. So you gotta know. And any officer, oh, and this is another thing that you need to be aware of. Anytime an officer, I don't care whether it's a male or a female, anytime an officer pats you down without your consent, here's where you get paid, folks. It has to be without your consent, and you have to say it verbally. I don't care what they think you done. They got no business putting their hands on you. That's called, that you can get up to, depending on where you live, you can get up to $100,000 per pat down. Or per feel or whatever. If they feel on the inside of your legs or the back of your buttocks or whatever, that's, you might as well be saying, count them pats. Be like, oh, you want to pat me down? I don't give you consent to touch my body. That's called sexual assault. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And see, if you're gonna get your thrills off feeling on me, you need to pay me. Cha-ching. So get that purpose. If they want to put their hands on you without you being consenting to it, you get that paperwork in to the right department. Find, and I tell you, you've got to educate yourself on this stuff. You file a claim of sexual assault by putting their hands on any parts of your body. So if these little nasty officers want to get their jollies, make their ass pay for it. Stop living in fear and start putting a price tag on it. That's all I'm saying. See, it's all about that money when they want to act funny. Ooh, that rhymes. I'm gonna have to put that on a t-shirt. Oh, it's all funny when you're messing with the money, or it's all money when they want to be funny. Okay, anyway. Anyway, moving on. There are 9 ingredients to being self-employed, folks. And you probably, if you've never been self-employed or you want to be self-employed, this is very crucial to any person that is in business. And I want you to write this stuff down. So number one, and I say it's 9 ingredients. Number one, know your product or your service that best suits you. Always write it down. Take it, you know, because our memory can fail us sometimes, and you're going to always need to have something to fall back on. And also, it helps you to put together a business plan in the event that you may need to get some money down the line in order to expand your business instead of you starting from scratch. If you got your notebook, if you already got your notebook and you're making notes to what you're doing, it'll come easy because you'll have the steps already there as to what you did and what you need to do, whatever your pluses and minuses are. Now, number two, there is a myth that you need to have money to get started. Not true. I don't care what type of business you're going into, because I'm going to tell you how if you do it the right way, you can build up that money to get whatever sources that you need to get. Take advantage. And the reason why I say that you don't need money to get started, because pretty much 90% of every business is online. I hate to say it, but all of these building franchises and, you know, places where you go into a store, unless you got a grocery store or a restaurant, pretty much everything else is done online. And even with the restaurants and the catering businesses, they start their business at home or online. And then by that time, they'll have the money to have that retail store or that grocery store to open up. But starting off, you have to take advantage of all your resources before spending your money on any type of supplies. You got to get the word out. You got to take advantage of the social media, like your Facebook, your Instagrams, your TikToks, what else? YouTube, all of these, you know, Twitter, all of the, you got to take advantage of all of these types of free sources. Number three, know your target market. Who's going to be buying your product, and why would they be buying from you? Give an example. You know, if you're in a bakery. If your thing is pastries and donuts and stuff, find a way to get some free samples out so people can try your food. And I tell people this, stop rushing. Do not rush to go get a website when you're first starting out. Don't do that. Build up your market first. That way you can keep a track of people coming to know about your product. Then go get a website. Then you can invest your money into getting a website. I wouldn't advise anyone to get a website until you are close to at least 5,000 or 10,000 people that know about your business. Because if you buy a website and nobody and you haven't built up your foundation first, it just makes no sense. It's almost like if you're going to build a house you went and bought the frame of the house, but you didn't spend money on the foundation. That's backwards. You don't really want to do that. So build up your market first. Build up, find out who's interested in your product. And then if you want and really necessarily need a website, then go back and get your website. Number four, always get your business, always find or get a business name and get your domain. Get that. I don't care if you don't use the domain yet. Go ahead and purchase it. Even if you got to hold on to it for a month or two, usually a domain name will start at about $2.99, and it'll go up. It can go up anywhere to $1,000, depending on the letters and the things that's associated with that name. So start doing your homework as far as finding a business name. Play around with it, because I had to play around with a lot of the names for my products and my businesses to see what will be a matching point for it. So number five, give something away. You got to have a free incentive or a free gift to drive people to your business. And the best way to do that is starting off with word of mouth. You go and tell, hey, I'm going to give y'all some free donuts if you drive traffic to my business, and they can find me on social media or whatever platform. You can find me on YouTube. You got to give something away. You got to make your business the appetizer before you serve them the actual meal. And that's just a metaphor. you got to give something away that is relevant to what you're selling. Don't make sure that it's in the same category as your business. Why I say that is, you don't want, if you have a car dealership, you may want to give away a car keychain. You know what I'm saying? Don't go in there talking about, well, we're going to give you a free meal. We're going to give you a free meal at Denny's. Okay. That's not in the same category with each other. Give something away that is relevant to what you are selling. If you're selling cars, then, give them a free ice scraper, something that would make a person come in and do a free test drive or whatever. So you gotta think outside the box. Number six, practice, and more practice with whatever you're in, whatever your expertise is, keep practicing. I mean, like, for instance, I'm in the singing. I have to sing, even though my shows are not going to be coming up until next year, I have to practice at least 3 times a week with all types of level of vocals. So whatever your field in, you got to practice. And another thing, when you're practicing, you always want to stay 2 steps ahead of your competitors. Always find out what your competitors are doing, because when you find out what your competitors are doing, you got to do it better than them or have something more out of the box than them. You always got to stay 2 steps ahead of the competitors by practice. I can't stress that enough with practicing. It makes a big difference. And like, for instance, in the music business, you have to practice because people are listening to you through sound. You have to sound, that sound and them, those notes and those keys have to be right. And I have ran into other musicians and bands, and they can't, I'm gonna be a little bit bold when I say this. They can't compete to my band, the Sapphire Blue Notes. My boys are bad. We don't mess around. So, but you got bands out here that think that they're all that and a bag of chip and an extra Dorito on the side. But the thing is, they don't practice. They come in and say, oh, well, we're just going to put this together. They're not in unison. They don't dress appropriate. I mean, it's a lot of points to doing a show, folks. It's not an easy task, and it's not for everybody. But they gas me on how they, you know, they want to try to out, you know, think it's competition with each other. You're not in no competition, because I'm going to do everything that your business is not going to do, because I'm going to stay two steps. No, matter of fact, in music, I'm going to stay five steps ahead of you. So while you sitting back there moaning and groaning about whatever, I'm out there doing what I got to do and getting in front of the audience that I need to get in front of. So, you know, you can sit there and be jealous if you need to. Anyway, so practice is number six. Number seven, you got to set goals on a weekly, monthly, and yearly basis. You got to set those goals. You got to strive for something in business. You got, and with doing that, you got to promote. I don't care if you spend 5 minutes a day. You got to promote your business. If you're trying to be self-employed, you got to be disciplined enough with your time, because you're not working a 9-to-5 job. And if you are working a 9-to-5 job, then you got to make that time fit into your schedule until you can go full-time self-employed. I'm not going to tell you, folks, it's not easy. It's not easy. My band is a 14-piece band. I'm responsible for 13 other people. You know, I have a rhythm section, I have a horn section, and I got a vocal section. And every one of these people got a different attitude, you know. So it's not easy. And they're some of the laziest people you ever want to meet too. They feel like they just want to get paid and not do the work. And I'm like, no, you're going to practice, and we're going to do this show, and the show is going to be awesome. And see, what they fail to realize is I can do it with them or without them. It doesn't really make any difference. I came back from Belize back in December doing a whole show without my band. You know, I could put them on a timeout. So when you get when people get to the point where they are more than what they think they are, then I have to bring them back to a reality check. You know, it's hard being a leader. It's hard being a leader sometimes. It's challenging, but it has its ups and its downs. So I say promote, and discipline yourself. And number eight, networking. Do you know how important it is to network with other businesses? And I'm going to tell you this, and I got to say this because I know too many Black men, and Black men have this major problem. Black men seem to think that when you're trying to talk business and network with them, their egos just run completely off of them. Guys, and I see, white men don't do this, and white people don't do this, but Black men is a creature of this. Black men, you guys need to take your head out the crack of your ass and hear what I'm saying. I'm not interested in you on a personal level. I'm really not. If I come to you, I'm trying to help you to be better at whatever you're trying to be better at, because I figure if we help each other, then we both can get what we need in the scheme of things. I'm not looking at somebody, because I don't believe you should shit where you eat. That's just my theory. You know, I'm out here networking. I love to network. I love to meet people. I love to see their business. And I want people, as much as I help another person in their business, they can help me with my business. You know, I could, and it don't have to be in the same type of business. I don't have to be around musicians all the time. I could be at a fundraising event and get to passing out business cards and say, hey, the next time you guys want a live quality band, give me a call, or whatever other products that I'm selling, or my books. That's another thing. If I'm at a book convention, I may be trying to promote a book or something, or one of my books. I got a long laundry of things that I'm out there promoting. But the thing is, networking is so important. And Black men just feel like they don't have to because they are who they are. But you got to think, nobody wants you but your mother. So stop with the foolishness. I mean, if I come to you and I say, look, I think so. I think we should network with each other. I think we should get together and maybe sit down over some over coffee or tea or health tonic or whatever. It's all about getting together and finding out what I can do for you and what you can do for me. Okay, so Black men, y'all need to really bend on that ego thing. I really do. And another thing, part of networking is another thing. And we're coming into number 9. This is where all businesses fail. Okay. Business failed to do one very important thing, and that is to advertise. They feel like, oh, I got the best cake in the world. But guess what, folks? If you can't be out there promoting that cake and having people to tell people where they can find that cake, you're the only person to know about that cake. Get off of this ego trip that just because you open up a restaurant, just because you have a service to offer, everybody don't know about that offer, that don't know you. Everybody don't know who you are. Everybody don't know if they want to participate with you or not. You know, that's just like with entertainers. And I'm not going to say any names. I'm not going to say any names because I know a lot of people in the entertainment business. And I respect the craft because we're family. But one thing what behooves me is that they feel like, well, I've been out, I got me a hit record. I've had several hit records and people ought to know who I am because my name is up in lights. But guess what? If you don't advertise and tell people, I don't care who you are. You could be Little Floyd Fauntleroy. You could be, from the Little Wrestling. You could be Buckwheat. Who cares? You need to advertise. Everybody, and see, this, you know, when you're doing a music concert, you need to do that music. You need to be advertising a whole year in advance. And see, Black people have a problem with advertising 2 weeks before the event. And then they be expecting, well, why didn't they come out to see us or hear us perform? Well, considering that you didn't advertise it long enough and you didn't advertise it to the targeted market, who's to say that you're going to come out and hear you? Now you're sitting up there mad because you only got 10 people in the audience and you can't sell no tickets. Okay. Hear me and hear me good. Yes. We all love R&B music. We all love hip hop music. We all love these different sorts of music. But if you're not going to advertise and tell me, look, hey, we're going to be at the casino in September of 2021, you need to be advertising that right now. Because I'm going to tell you something, and Black people know this. They know this about our people. Our people are the slowest people to do. They don't do nothing on time. They won't buy tickets early. See, only white people buy tickets early, which is the reason why they get all those front row seats. But Black people will not buy a ticket early. They will not do it. I don't care what you say. I don't care what you do. They will not buy a ticket early. They are the last come Johnny come lately when it comes to doing a show. And you ought to know this. If you are a celebrity, I don't care if you got your little celebrity status. I don't care. You know for a fact that Black people need a layaway plan for a $50 ticket. You know this. So don't be, you know, you got to advertise to people a year in advance. You need to let people know where you planning on being. So give them that enough time, because if you sit up here and here it is November, let's say this is November. If this is November and you got a concert or a concert in 2 weeks, okay, well, why the hell didn't somebody tell us that this person was coming to town? Did nobody know that you were coming to town? And then now you sitting up there mad because you only got 10 people in your audience and you can't sell tickets. Oh, wow. Okay. So if you're gonna, you know, you got to learn You got to learn how to advertise, folks. And this is the down thing that people will not put money into. They feel like I am a big brand name and I've been out there 50 years or I've been out there 30 years and people ought to know who the hell I am. But if they don't know that you're coming to their town, you need to tell these people, look, so-and-so is coming to town. Don't you want to go see the show? Let's go get our tickets early. Get, you know, wow. I'm just saying. So if you have money to put into a business, make sure that you're putting it towards on a monthly basis. Monthly. You should be advertising some kind of way on a monthly basis. I tell you, I have to say this again. You can have the best cake in the world, but if nobody have ever tried that cake and don't know that you bake cakes, then the number one mistake is not getting that word out about doing that. And business fails because they do not put a budget advertisement in their business plan. They do not budget advertisement. They just feel like because they are who they are, that's going to draw in a crowd. And that is so far from the truth. So, and anybody to start up in a business, or if you are already in a business, I say this for whatever you're advertising for, everybody needs an IP package. Now, what is an IP package? An IP package is an introductory mail package. It is a simple postcard. It's a 4x6 postcard, colored postcard that's done by a professional printer. And you mail it to your targeted market 7 times. And you can practically, people respond to those postcards. If they know that you're coming to town and you didn't done it and you're giving them, you're making their mouth water to get to that performance, I'm telling you, there was this veterans, they had like a veterans thing for the military people. They give a party here in the town that I live in. Every October, they always give a grand big old street party for people who have served in the military. Okay, great thing to do, no problem. And the thing is, if you are a person who has served in any of the branches of military, they send you a free coupon to get yourself a free meal from one of their participating sponsors to show our appreciation, how much we love the people who have served in the military. So, but the thing is, they advertise. They advertise a whole year in advance. And by the time October comes around, when they're doing their veterans thing, whatever it is that they do, that place be packed. I'm like, man, are you serious? People are just coming out just to see military salute and stuff. I mean, that's no offense. Don't get me wrong. I love military people, but the performance of it all is so boring. It's just boring. But the fact of the matter is, they had to turn people away because these people have sat up and made advertising a part of their plan. And then another thing. Here's another a great idea, and this is some more stuff for you for free. If you are a restaurant owner, and you got a restaurant, and let's say, for instance, that Wednesdays is your slow day, okay, then you need to take that slow day and find a reason to get people into that restaurant. Have a chicken, even if it's a chicken and waffle day, if that's your specialty, then say, look here, folks, come in on Wednesday from 2 to 6 and get half off on chicken and waffles. And advertise. Okay. And you just want to keep the customers coming back for more. All right, guys, I have given you enough information this evening to reach out to your girl. I'm gonna tell it to you one more time before I get ready to close it up and close it out. That's HEOR class 101 at gmail.com for all your comments, questions, concerns, or to receive my free email book that is valued at $25. If you want to send me a list of what laws you would like to see change for your community, you got to send that in to me. Or And I'll show you how to put that together. Or if you like to join the free wholesale club by my sponsor, this wholesale club is only by personal invite. This is not advertised to the general public. So you're not going to see this advertised. And the sales that you get behind this wholesale club is unreal. I just received my skin softener. I spent $13 per bottle. I mean, huge bottles. These are huge bottles. So I'll probably be using that skin softener for a while. But anyway, it's not to the general public. You have to contact me so I can give you that special code so you can get your free membership. And that's at ator101@gmail.com. And like I said to you before, I'm going to be doing the Black American Plan by filing a motion in the Supreme Court. I'm putting all of that together. I told you once before, I'm just about done with it. And I'm going to be giving a copy to all of the militant groups who are dealing with issues with white government. And then I will be opening it up for the general public to see these pages that I will be filing on behalf of Black America. Anybody interested, again, you have to go, send me an email with your request to atorclass101@gmail.com. For all donations, please send your invoice to atouchofreality2@gmail.com. That's atouchofreality2@gmail.com. Now, this week, I'm going to be doing lesson 7 this week, a week early, because next week, I said again, next week is going to be the election where all of these fools are going out there voting. So I'm going to lay low because I don't know what's going to transpire on whoever wins. I'm just going to be away from the crowd. So lesson 7, I will be doing live this Thursday. And folks, I tell you, I'm all about solutions. I'm so sick and tired of people complaining about what white government and what police officers are doing. Stop complaining. And I keep telling you to pick up that pen. It's all in the power of the pen. We could get these problems solved if everybody give us, if we could get 1 million signatures, we can change all of these laws. All of these laws can be changed through the power of the pen. And it starts with us doing it one by one and us stepping up to the plate. Get off of my thing there. I don't want you down there. Okay. Now, I get these little bells that tell me that, oh, somebody else wants to come in. No, I'm busy right now. Now, anyway, as I was saying, all these laws can be changed by the power of the pen if everybody steps up. So I want to say thank you. I appreciate you guys spending your time with me tonight. I am Linda Evans. I am the queen of radio. And I'm going to say thank you for joining me and taking the time out to be with me this evening. And I hope that you guys have learned something from my class. So I'm going to say good night, and I'll be seeing you guys over the top. Good night, everyone. Thank you.